gonna deal with. So, background on this to the viewing public?
You guys wanna take this?
What's the current state of affairs?
Well, we met with DEP in Springfield Friday, resolved one of the issues in regards to the chlorinator. That will be implemented in by next week. The second issue in regards to Wayne's hours, I had a call to Boston yesterday and could not contact, I talked to two other people there that didn't have the information I needed. The guy I needed to talk to won't be in till Friday. That's the only day he works. So I can't resolve that issue until I talk to him. But right now, DEP in Springfield is more than satisfied on both issues, told us not to sign the papers and hold off. So I guess you can kind of say that it's everything's sort of been resolved except for talking to Boston in regards to his license.
And you think that'll be resolved on Friday?
Not completely. Not completely, but I hope, yeah, that we'll be on the right path with them.
So what do you see the likely future working out to be in terms of?
In regards to the license?
Yeah.
I don't know. It depends on how Boston responds back to me about Wayne already, you know, have time in with us. So I'll just have to wait and see how, you know, how that works out with them.
Okay, so you'll get back to us after you have your conversation with Boston.
Okay. At a very minimum, you're going to end up paying more in labor because it's going to be at least 24 hours a week where it used to be 20. The consent order calls for 2 hours, for some strange reason, 2 hours of staffing in that building on Saturday and Sunday. They want somebody in there, 2 hours Saturday, 2 hours. Doesn't have to be the primary operator. It can be the backup.
Oh, okay. So that's good.
But it's still for whatever reason, they want somebody sitting in that building for 2 hours a day.
I'm familiar with Boston's procedures, and they're a little more urban-centric or Cape-centric with regard to lots of water issues, including Title V.
It is what it is.
It is what it is, yeah. And so we have little towns to that just, you know, treat like bigger towns.
I don't personally see them bending a whole lot on the certified operator part of this thing. You're going to have somebody with a license 20 hours a week.
Right, and that's a question. So what's the likely scenario there? Wayne, how long is that going to take, or do we have to put it out for, you know, somebody else?
I got what I sent in, month and a half, 2 months ago,
right.
3 months ago. I got that back Friday, right before we left to go to Springfield. And they changed the application, I think it was like a month ago. So they sent all my stuff back to send it back again with the new application.
Okay. So you fill out the new application, you send that back in, and then what are we looking at?
They meet, when did they meet? The first?
Every month.
First week every month. Is it Wednesdays, Fridays?
First Friday of the month.
Friday in a month.
But when did they get you on the agenda?
We have.
It
will be right away.
Yeah, what is it, May? So it'll be the first Friday in June.
Okay, so they put you on right away. They don't. Yeah. There's not a waiting period.
No.
And what might the likely outcome of that meeting be?
They'll either issue the license, the full license, or they'll issue you an operator and training license.
You might get a full license then.
Right. It all depends if they think I had enough hours in to this point now.
And so if you don't get the full license, if you get an operator in training, then we have to get somebody with a full license.
Yeah.
For the interim. I don't know how long might the interim be.
It's up to the license board to make that decision.
But there are like two people in the, you know, Northeast with that full license, from what I understand.
Wow, you saw how many applicants we had when we had.
That's my point, right.
So. Yeah, the DEP, when we were talking to them, knows that. He said, you're not the only town like this, because it's hard. If somebody goes and, like he said, if somebody goes and gets the full licenses, they don't want to work a part-time job. They want full-time jobs.
Well, what about Sharon? Did we look at the Sharon?
We asked about that.
Yeah.
Like with Sunderland, for instance. Do they have a full-time licensed op person?
I don't know if he works full-time or not.
Well, but he's licensed, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so hopefully maybe he doesn't. Yeah, I mean, we need to cast a full net in terms of who out there has a full licensed operator.
We actually, you need two.
Okay, we'll cast two nets.
Because you need the guy that's going to be there 20 hours a week, the full-time operator, and then you need the backup guy.
Right, well, I'm assuming that's
that
you.
That still has to have the licenses.
But the backup can be an in-trainer.
Yes. No?
Yes.
Yeah,
you can.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Secondary operator could be an OIT.
Right.
Which is what he is already.
Exactly.
He's passport.
So we need to find
a licensed operator.
That's willing to pick up 20 hours a week.
There's also an emergency licensing provision.
Yeah.
Cover situations like this that you can apply for. That if they'll say, yeah, we'll grant him his license in 6 months, apply for the emergency license, which is good for 6 months.
Perfect.
The two things may,
right,
by the grace of God, they may intersect and it might work.
I'm sort of with Bill on this in terms of the chances that they're going to be flexible at all with all the water stuff that's in the news these days. They are not going to bend at all if there's any risk that some catastrophic event could take place, whether it's a realistic, thought or not. They're not going to bend at all. They're going to want to make sure that our water is securely protected, as should we. So I think we need to find that town that's willing to, that has a part-time operator. And I have to believe they exist.
Well, we should pursue all options that are available to us.
Like yesterday.
Like including that, which we talked about.
Well, there are, there are companies out there that do it.
Right.
You can hire temporary operators.
Then we may need to do that.
Contract operators who do this for a living, they service. I knew a guy who had 30 systems.
Well, then great.
But he just went from one to the other.
Right.
Because they were small enough that they didn't require somebody in the building all the time.
We have the body in the building in the person in training, in theory. Right. Let's look for towns and look for consultants.
DEP is supposed to send us a list of people that are available. So.
And I appreciate that, George, but my guess is that these guys can work faster than DEP on this.
The other issue here was the chlorine, monitoring the chlorine.
Yeah, I told you that would be implemented next week. We've already purchased the machinery we need for it, so we're going to install it next week.
We've had one for years.
Has chlorine been a problem?
No.
The difficulty with that particular kind is the iron and the manganese. It keeps binding up the membrane. The guy would come, he came from Maine. I would pay him a whole lot of money to come down here and fix it. It would work for 2 or 3 days and it would get bound up with iron and manganese again. This particular one that's going to be installed on Monday doesn't have the same kind of issues. That thing is worked on and off. We've always had it, but it wasn't dependable. So this one should be fine.
The issues here were provoked by the loan. If we didn't apply for that loan for the pilot program, I don't think we'd even be here talking right now. Because they've even mentioned that Friday at the meeting we had with them. So this is what provoked it. It's not necessarily that we are doing something wrong. It's just that they're just trying to have their checkoff list because we applied for that loan.
DEP had to certify to the State Revolving Fund that Whately was compliant system before the State Revolving Fund would give them any money. And Springfield couldn't do that because we are not compliant.
So if you change your continuous monitoring for chlorine, how is this going to affect your manganese problem that you're getting filters for? Is this compatible or?
Yes.
We don't know.
They kind of.
Well, the CL17, the high CL17 doesn't have a membrane and electrolytes in it like this other foolish thing does.
The one that's in there now gets gummed up from that manganese, where this one won't.
But you're going to also treat the manganese with a different filter, aren't you?
Right, but the chlorine and the manganese are two separate things.
Okay.
Are we going to be compliant at the end of the day with our water and what's in our water?
The water is.
Yeah, we have.
The water will continue to be.
Yeah, the water is fine.
It's always been chlorinated.
I get that, and it should be.
We've always tested with spectrophotometer. You take a little sample, you put the reagent in, you put it in the machine, and the spectrophotometer tells you how much chlorine is in there. What they've been looking for over time, especially finally made it down to the smaller systems, is continuous monitoring. It's into your data loggers. You can open up your laptop and see what the chlorine level was at all times, all day long, as opposed to what they call a grab sample. Where you grab some water, put in the reagent, see what it reads. You want a continuous reading over a 24-hour period so you can report the lowest chlorine residual.
Yeah. And this is because this is best available technology.
It is now.
It is now, and it wasn't 5 years ago. And 10
years
ago,
everybody used to use a spectrophotometer. You take a little jar, fill it with water, and put the stuff in it, and do it that way.
And 20 years ago, nobody used that.
Right.
They just hoped that there was enough chlorine.
The pool test kit,
yeah.
Same thing.
Right.
That's basically what it amounts to.
Okay. So we're going to get a list real soon of people who can possibly help.
And we're going to hear Friday from Boston. Something.
Hopefully. Meaning that if I can contact the guy in Boston.
So we have a lot of strategies. We have the 6-month thing, you know, possibly holding this over until Wayne maybe then gets...
Yeah.
Full certification or licensing, or we have the contracting. We have the 31st town on this guy's list, or whoever it is.
Don't be shocked because there isn't a lot of youth on this issue in Boston. They can be somewhat attractive when it comes to staffing.
I'm sure they can. I'm confident about that. I have infinite faith in Boston. Okay, good. Anything else?
Gotta go to work.
Go to work. So, John, you're still chair. You want to take this next one?
Sure. Hi, guys. How are you? Cell tower. We've got, Mark, you can tee it up, but we've got two payment options. We accepted the American
cell. You guys come closer.
As you guys probably know, we accepted the bid for American Tower.
Would you like us to sit there?
Wherever you want to sit.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, I have some background information that we can go over.
What's your quorum?
4. We're supposed to have one more. Dan.
That's 3. Okay.
Jim is. He said he was coming.
What are you looking at?
Okay, that's fine.
Money.
Yeah, that's fine. You know what? Let's wait for Jim one more second, Mark, because it's only appropriate. You guys want to sit up here?
We have 3 more, right? Jim.
In theory.
Right, so if Jim comes, we have a quorum.
Right, and we can push down. Well, I mean, it's up to you guys. I'll sit in the audience, I don't care.
Over there.
Until they have a quorum, let's go to the SCIMS RFP response versus the school proposal, and I'll try to keep my... I'm getting phone calls on this, and it's giving me a headache.
I've had a headache since January.
So...
You married her.
The issue here is that I need some final direction from you guys as to how best to move forward now that we've seen the final RFP that was posted by Deerfield. I did speak to Doug yesterday. He said the intent is... The intent is not to exclude Sunderland and Whately.
That's the intent.
That's the intent.
What's the language?
The language would say otherwise, I guess.
What's council say?
Council has not weighed in on this. We were in the process of working with council on the water issue. And I'm not sure that we really need council's advice on this. It does say building space in the town, which to me sounds like Deerfield, and Doug agreed with that. But Doug wrote the RFP, and his explanation for that when I spoke to him yesterday was that it was a template used from...
Well, this is the problem when people use templates. It's a lazy man's way of accomplishing anything.
And when, and but it's too late to do anything about it. The RFP's
The RFP's posted, and we just need to know.
Jim, you can sit up here,
you know,
with your colleagues.
I guess where I need some direction from you guys is, how do you feel about the language? Do you want me to spend, I have about a week of time left in the town, and I will focus on this if this is what you want me to do, or we can shift gears and...
In my opinion, we've discussed this already. We saw the language at the last meeting. We didn't change. We need to continue to move forward. The language in the first paragraph is not part of the weighting scale. The weighting scale is the weighting scale, and if we go outside that point system, that's the issue. The point system of the, and I don't have it in front of me right now, but the positives, the negatives, and the neutrals, and that's semantics. That's how this is going to be proposed. The fact that Deerfield messed up on the first paragraph of the RFP doesn't impact the weighting scale of how they are supposed to decide, and how SCAMS is going to recommend to the Board of Selectmen of Deerfield how the Board of Selectmen should proceed. Remember, the Board of Selectmen of Deerfield, per the MOA,
IMA,
is supposed to accept the recommendation of SCAMS. They don't get to use it as advisory. They're supposed to accept it. So SCAMS will use the weighting system, and if we craft a good response, we will win this thing. The first paragraph has nothing to do with the weighting system. It's a whoops by the town of Deerfield.
Yeah, but legally somebody could look at the first paragraph and say Whately's not eligible because you're not in the town. And that would just take us out of the running.
But the weighting scale is the weighting scale.
Well, right, but legally, somebody could come back to that first paragraph, and if there's proposals being written by Deerfield people, they're not sitting back just waiting. They're moving forward with their proposals. We hear they're developing proposals for other locations.
I have a few points of information that I'd like clarified. One is the selection of the site of SCAMS is a determination by all three participating towns have to agree on the location. Is that correct?
The Board of Selectmen of all three
Board towns. Of Selectmen of Sunderland, Whately, and Deerfield.
There's some, my understanding is that, right, well, it is fact that the IMA currently says town meetings in each of the towns decides that. But my understanding is that council has advised that the three select boards could amend the IMA, that you have the authority in that under Mass General Law to amend that IMA and make that decision between the three towns. There's not, Doug has a different opinion on that, so he thinks it still needs to go to town meeting votes in all three towns, but we'll have to get a final determination on that.
All right, so let me ask a different question. If, given what's happening now, the town of Deerfield issued the RFP, they're the fiscal agent. They will receive the proposals, right, from any bidders or responders to the RFP. Then the decision, then the proposals, then, correct me if I'm wrong, go to the Board of Oversight?
For review and
score. For review, and then what happens to those proposals?
They'll score them and make a recommendation to the Deerfield Select Board.
And then what happens?
And then, I guess at that point, the Deerfield Select Board takes a stance.
So the Deerfield Select Board could say yay or nay right there?
But that would be
the other towns?
They could.
I suppose.
So Deerfield has the ultimate power on this. So my question is, we've waited long enough. We have somebody who wants to move into this building and would actually pay a higher rate.
I don't care about paying.
We gave SCAMS a great deal. We bent over backwards.
We made a proposal to them already.
We can't just walk away from our partnership with SCAMS. That puts us in the same shoes as the town of Deerfield in terms of how we choose or not choose to act as a board. We are of our word. This is ethics as well.
Well, sure, it's ethics, but you know, we have a fiduciary responsibility to the town to not leave our building empty, which we sold to our town based on the agreement we thought we had with
Well, we sold the board, we sold the town based upon the possibility of added revenue. We could afford it without it even, because we had to do something.
Part of the sales was to have the emergency medical system in this building. And that convinced a lot of people to forget the town hall and move into this building. Yeah.
Are there timeframes based on the new entity that likes to come in? Have they put a ceiling or a floor on this?
Maybe Bob can speak to that. The new entity being the school?
I don't know who this is. So the school is in the Frontier Regional?
Superintendent's Office.
Superintendent's Office is interested in taking this.
We've been interested in this since January.
Okay.
We were told we would know by Deerfield's town meeting, that we know how that ended up.
Well, but that was fixed. That was not a regular town meeting, that was a special town meeting. That's a separate issue. We don't know that it would turn out the same way with a town meeting that had more on the line than a referendum. We don't know that.
That's what we had waited as a town of Whately. We said to them, correct me if I'm wrong, that we had to wait until April 25th or 27th, whatever their meeting was, and we would have a better idea by that day whether Stems was going to come in or not. And now it's going to be another possibly 4 or 5 months, and we were ready in possibly in January or February going forth with something. Now we're going to wait until fall to find out for the 120 days.
And we're assuming what the Deerfield Select Board would do. We should not assume that.
We should not assume that at all.
They're credible people, and they're working in the best interest of their town.
That's right.
So,
and they're responding to their constituents.
And if we suddenly turn around and say, no, we're going to go with the school department as residents of this building, we are the ones, make no mistake, we are the ones ending the possibility of Skims residing in this building. Not the town of Deerfield, not the town of Sunderland. We will be.
I don't know if I necessarily agree with that. We made a proposal to them over a year ago, and even 2 years ago, when we were developing plans, and they showed interest. And nothing has happened in the last 6 months in response to our proposal. We haven't heard anything. So how long are we going to sit here and wait? Another 6 months? And then you don't know if you're going to get an answer then or not.
And then if we decide to do this, you name me one other location that would provide the public safety to the residents of Whately that this location would for Skims.
We don't know that. They're looking at other locations. We don't know where else they're looking at, Jonathan. There could be other possibilities just as well as this.
The Baxter Report went through this region and highlighted a 1.8 square mile region or something like that about where the optimum location would be for public safety for not just the residents of Whately, but for the residents of Sunderland and the residents of Deerfield. That is in the report, clear as day.
Okay, but there's new locations being looked at, not only our location, but others.
It's the geographic range.
John, the question is, we all know that, we agree with that. We were led to believe that that's the way things were going to happen.
And we don't know that it won't.
The town of Deerfield issues an RFP saying, well, we're not sure we want Whately because we might get a better deal somewhere else. Well, that's not playing by the rules either.
Yeah. You think that's possible, that they get a better deal somewhere else?
Could happen.
I think that they could, somebody could make them an offer. They would accept it. We'd be out of the race, and then they would find out, and we would find out, it's actually more expensive. But, you know,
that's what I think this is a very expensive proposal. I think downstream, if we get into a situation and we stay in the Skims, that it is an expensive entity to provide to the public, and it can jump exponentially in costs. Well, if we don't offer them this rock bottom and we have to stay with them and go somewhere else where they have to build a facility or do something else, we may be forced out of that. And I think that would also be, undesirable.
Well, I think Skims is a great deal. No matter how we cut it, I don't want to jump ship from Skims because they're providing better coverage. Whether it's in this building or South Deerfield, I would still rather be in Skims. But I think we run the risk of incurring more expense if it's not in this building.
Absolutely.
No problem is, and there's no doubt about that, John. I agree, I can't imagine they could find a better place.
I couldn't agree more.
The problem is, I don't get the feeling that we can rely on what's been going on here because we've been jerked around, frankly. And now we have an RFP. If it's such a good deal, why is there an RFP?
Because that provides the ultimate transparency. That it's not Skims looking and saying, you know what, we're going to go with our friends in Whately. It is a...
Well, we have that report you talked about.
I understand that, but it's a transparent search to make sure that no one else is going to pull a rabbit out of a hat. And that's truly what it would be to find a better location than this at a better cost than this.
I agree. They're not going to find that, but
they're not going to find it. And the people and all the residents of all three towns should understand that they are not going to find a better deal.
Well, evidently there's some residents who don't understand that, and I don't believe they will ever understand that.
Well, but that's okay. That's why
it's not okay if they stuff
it's minority versus majority
against it.
And they're looking for a short term. I mean, they're only looking for what, 3 to 5 year lease for here. Then they're going to look for, they've even said that, a permanent location. They're not considering this as permanent right now. 3 years.
What would it take to amend that IMA so that it gets pulled off town floor and it gets in the hands of select boards?
My understanding is that three towns agree on amending the IMA.
The boards
talked about
agree.
Getting together the three towns to amend the IMA. Mm-hmm. It just didn't happen.
Well, I think we should do that.
You could also make
an annual town meetings kind
because
of push
of the unknown
aside,
of the, of the we're constitution of the Deerfield Select Board.
We could just have a meeting with the three boards and decide that
we don't. That's an unknown.
Deerfield Select Board has already voted to amend the IMA.
Oh, they have.
They have. There's one. That was supposed to be a conversation with all three towns.
Okay. What are we talking about here?
Yeah, Jonathan, you need to hear what Mark just said.
We were talking about the IMA and what the process would be. My understanding is that the three towns need to get together and amend the IMA. Deerfield has already, on their own, voted to amend the IMA.
To be inclusive of all towns, all three.
No,
to change the wording.
They've just voted the change. I had forwarded you guys some proposed changes a while ago.
And they voted that.
They voted that. So my understanding was that the three towns would get together, have a conversation about it, and vote together to amend.
So why don't, if Deerfield's already accepted the language that we talked about, why don't we just independently vote to amend
that? We can. It just eliminates the conversation. If there's something you don't agree with and they've already voted, it just seems like an easier, cleaner process to have all three towns in one room, one document, vote on it.
How do you feel about the language that they voted?
I don't have any problem with the language. I think the only snag in it was there's some difference of opinion on adding the voting member for Deerfield as the fiscal agent. I'm not sure everyone agrees that's a good option.
The Board of Oversight of Skims at the last meeting that I attended thought that we should increase, should allow for the two alternate votes for both, as an alternate for both of the current members.
And that's why I think all three select boards should be in the room together instead of individually discussing a document that we all need to agree on. I'm not sure why Deerfield decided to go that way. Doug sent an email saying, this is what we did, you guys should do what you want to do and take care of your own town, so.
Well, I agree with Jonathan. I think we should meet together, like next week. I won't be here, but who's ever here? And get this ironed out, because this space is sitting there and we've got a potential party who's very interested and has been for several months to move in and create a revenue stream, which, you know, is a consideration, as is having the EMS located there. I'm torn about this because, you know, I put a lot of political capital in supporting the EMS being in this building. I'd like to see it there. On the other hand, right now it's not there, and it won't be there for 4 months, maybe 5 months, and even then, evidently the town of Deerfield could nix it. So I'm a little worried about that.
What difference is going to make changing the IMA now? Explain to me why. What's the difference and why we should do this right now?
Because then the select boards of each of the towns could vote on their own to house the skims wherever it chose. The IMA currently says that it has to be done on town meeting floor in each of the three towns. So it would remove town meeting floor from the formula and just make it a select board vote from each of the three towns.
And could that happen before the RFP is decided on, the results of the RFP, or do you have to wait for the RFP and then?
Well, apparently the town of Deerfield already voted to support that. I don't know what else is in their language, which version they voted on, but apparently they already voted that.
I don't know. I think we were all under the impression that we were going to hold a three-town meeting, whether we probably host it here again and get everyone in the same room, but that process didn't.
Well, Mark, let me ask you, what's to prevent us from voting that small change and then just going back and amending the IMA again to reflect other changes when the three towns do meet? I mean, to Fred's point, if we can get before the RFP is closed or issued, whichever one, I'm not sure which Fred was suggesting, we have at least the consensus that the location can be chosen by the three select boards, and then other changes that we want to make can be made during a three-town select board meeting, which I agree we should have. So what's the...
Why don't I get a copy of the version Deerfield voted on and send that to you? And then we can try to... I haven't seen it, so I don't know.
We can't vote on language we don't have.
Is that the one you sent to us here? June 3rd response date?
Well, that's the RFP. I'm talking about the IMA.
Oh. Yeah, I don't think you sent that.
Can I just make one more comment regarding this whole process? If you think about it, if you think about this EMS thing, if we can control the rent, think of any small business, what ends up being the downfall usually over time is that the landlord controls the revenue stream. So if we can control the rent here, for the EMS department, we can make it that much more affordable for the people of this town as well as all three towns. Now, granted, superintendent's office would be great. I don't know what the money stream there would be, but if this EMS thing does not work, we may need, dollar-wise, to get more money out of that rental than what they're willing to offer. So we may have to go to a commercial side. And I mean, that's a possibility.
We can't do that.
It's not a possibility, actually.
No?
We can only rent, under USDA loan, we can only lease space back to a public entity.
What if we paid it off?
Then we own it, we can do whatever we want.
Okay. So just the option.
Another thing with regard to that, my understanding is that we offered basically skims a rate of around $5 a square foot. The commercial rate is 15-ish a square foot, and in between is 10, which I don't think would be outlandish to offer somebody else who's not skims.
Right.
So it might behoove us, just from a fiscal point of view, to go with somebody else. Because skims, we offered them a bait. I thought they couldn't refuse, but evidently...
And skims didn't refuse.
Skims didn't, but skims doesn't have much say in this, it seems.
Well, you may need those kind of dollar flow if, in fact, this skims thing, and we're still in it, goes to Deerfield, and whomever the landlord might be. So not only do we have EMT and medical costs and all that insurance on top of it, we have a housing cost that nobody's controlling.
Right, right. That's it's a risky situation as far as I can tell.
Well, which way?
Well, I think, well, I'd like to know how much risk the superintendent's office is involved in the superintendent's office.
Right, you know, just to fill everybody in what's going on, we've had some studies done at the Blue School, health issues. We have some people not even working there. They're either working out of another location. There's some serious problems there, but not serious enough that with approximately $500,000 to fix every little thing there, then you're still not guaranteed. So I know Mark and Marty Barrett has been working close on ideas on price, how much it costs for the company. I saw it briefly, the cubicles. Yeah. And stuff, and it looks reasonable. I mean, the prices, whatever, you know, you guys come up with. I know they've been talking about price. And, you know, I just feel as though that, hey, I'm all for STEM staying here. You know, that was the goal of a lot of us taxpayers when we purchased this, that we had the understanding that STEM was going to come in and they were going to pay a rent to our town. And you know, how, you know, like everybody's saying, how long it's going. I think Paul had the best thing when he said, if we get, I'm not gonna say a bad word, but if we get pulled around for a long time and say the superintendent's office goes in here, Paul had the right idea. They're just waiting, they're gonna go build somewhere, they're gonna add on to the fire station, and they're gonna have their sweet little thing. We've been bullied enough. We've been bullied for years from Deerfield, and you can quote me on that. We know that. You know, bullying in school is a no-no. Well, like bullying by towns is a no-no, as far as I'm concerned.
Bob, let me ask you then, if we shifted our focus to the superintendent's office as a possible tenant here, who makes that decision? And what's the timeline on that?
School board, Frontier School Board makes that decision.
How would you estimate their, likely vote on this?
There was a straw vote taken. I think it was 7 out of 9, roughly.
So a clear.
I'm the secretary. I wrote it down somewhere as a straw vote, but I think it was like 7 out of 9 members in favor of possibly continuing on and finding all the variables. The subcommittee has their first meeting this afternoon at 2:00 at the superintendent's office to discuss possibilities and floor plans and pricing and everything like that. So our first meeting's at 2:00.
Have we received any information from the superintendent's office regarding their interest in occupying the space in writing?
I don't think
you think will at some point?
Well, we looked at all variables already about if we had to get out of the Blue School and this wasn't available over here, what we could possibly do. Believe it or not, there's really no place that you could take over a wing at the high school, because some high school school systems have their superintendent and offices in the high school. There really wasn't. Darius was on at the meeting the other night, and we tried to talk to him about asking him different questions about, well, we can put 2 people over here and 2 people over here, but there again, you know, when these people work throughout the summer, there's no air conditioning in any of those areas that we're talking about, and there's really no wing to take it over. And I mean, certain people got to be together. You can't put one in an 8th grade classroom down here, and it's basically we would have to take over classrooms.
Well, my concern simply is that I've got to look after Whately, after, you know, our Absolutely. Residents, our taxpayers, et cetera, et cetera. So I want to have our ducks in a row before we make any decisions one way or the other. And right now, I don't know about the school superintendent's, the superintendent's office reality here. And I'm very skeptical about what's going on with SCAMS.
I think we all are. I mean, only thing I can tell you for an area and how many square feet we need, it's a perfect fit. And it's not like the only way we would, I'm just speaking for myself, the only reason we would leave if we ever had to leave, if for some reason something happens at the high school and our population of 700 kids goes down to 400 kids and we have open wings, that'd be the only other way that we could ever possibly move in over there if the population drops, which I don't foresee it.
Well, whoever moves into the space, A, I want somebody in there as soon as possible, and I want them to sign a lease that's as long as possible so we have a stable revenue flow.
John, you've been patient. What do you got?
Well, regarding the time frame, isn't my understanding is there's a meeting May 31st and you guys are hoping to have some kind of proposal to present to the school boards or something?
To the select board. We have our meeting on the 31st. I think their next meeting is the 31st. Is that correct, Mark? The 31st?
This board meeting's
the 31st. Our subcommittee, including Marty, will be going to the select board meeting.
Okay.
We're on the agenda.
So the ideal thing, if that was to happen and we came to an agreement, I would think that the school department would want to move during the summer months versus during the school year.
Correct.
So are you saying or are you thinking that the possibility is to get this done over the summer?
Yes.
You have
we don't want to do it. We don't want to do it after school opens. It's chaotic trying to have people doing their job and trying to move at the same time. I mean, it's
my reaction to that right away is, so now we're faced with maybe a 4-month delay with SCAMS with this RFP thing, but if we don't get you in here by September 1st or whenever school starts, we could be looking at a 12-month delay. And I'd have to go with SCAMS at that point.
It all depends on what happens with.
Yeah, there's a lot of balls in the air right now.
But you know, we'll know more when we meet with you guys on the 31st. We can present, I guess we're gonna be presenting you with, we got layouts already and cost and.
This town proceeded with, we said, yeah, we gave a wink and a nod to the RFP process as the next step. For SCAMS. Why are we not seeing that process through? I'm completely
We are, it's happening.
No, we had a conversation right here at this table, whether we should proceed, whether Mark should spend the last week and a half that we have him here to be responding to an RFP.
Fine with that.
If this doesn't move forward, if anyone thinks that the continuation of SCAMS is a sure thing, their political glasses are really foggy.
What you're asking for is if we should have Mark submit a proposal.
Well, that's what I'm asking for, whether you want me to write a proposal for your meeting on the 31st.
It's due the 3rd?
It's due the 3rd.
It should be written so we can review a draft and we can have a couple sets of eyes take a look at it, absolutely.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And I'm for that. I'm not throwing SCAMS out, but I don't want to throw the superintendent's office out either. I mean, that's where I'm a little torn between our responsibility to the town from a fiscal point of view and our commitments from a political.
And our responsibility to the town from a public safety point of view.
And public safety.
This is the best location for ambulance service delivery around. Make no mistake
about
it. And
that's what the Board of Oversight has repeatedly told us.
Exactly. And if anyone says otherwise, they are either kidding themselves or lying to someone in their face. It is the best location for response times and public safety in the three towns.
In terms of what may be the best route to go here, okay, we look at all the options. If you think about it, if the select boards of all three towns had the authority to make decisions on SCAMS, SCAMS would be in there right now.
That's correct.
The outlier are a few naysayers in the town of Deerfield who are pretty much uneducated regarding what needs to happen. If you can't remove the power from that group by changing the IMA, then I would make it known to SCIMS that if we can't do that and bring control to the boards and not let all three towns be held hostage by a half dozen, dozen, 100 people over in Deerfield, whatever it is, then we're going to move forward with another.
But Deerfield's already done that, I think. I think, again, I don't know what the specific language is, but I think the vote of the Deerfield Select Board was to have that decision made solely by the three of them and not by town meeting.
Well, that would be so, that would be good.
I'm not sure about that.
You're not sure about that? No, I thought that's what Doug, you said.
Doug has a different opinion. My understanding from council was that the boards of selectmen have the authority to amend the IMA. Within the IMA, it says that it requires a town meeting vote. So, in theory, you should be able, you guys signed, you guys put that language in there, you should be able to remove it.
So, they, did they remove that language in
that
there?
I don't know. I haven't
seen. Let's find that out.
We've got to find that out. Also, I think we got to meet with the other select boards ASAP before we have a meeting on the 31st with the school committee. Because then we will rule out what Paul raised as a very important issue.
Right.
This IMA thing.
John?
And we want control over our destiny, I think.
You know, as you guys know, I've been pretty involved over the last almost 2 years with trying to get SCIMS in here and talking at town meeting of the fact that we have the potential rental ability when we buy this building. And I think a lot of people understood that. I think things have changed to the point now where I'm thinking, having been to a lot of SCIMS meetings, having watched some of the Deerfield meetings, and you know what's going on, you got two new select people over there in Deerfield. They're not up to speed on what's been going on. If we don't do something fairly soon, and I think that the school department would be a good fit there at this point, times have changed. If we remodel at 3,000 square feet that I think they're looking for, it's a much, much easier remodel, much easier. Then you look at the long-term thing of SCIMS. It's been said more than once at their meeting that they want to be in their own building. Their own building.
I don't think SCIMS has ever said that.
Oh, yeah, they have.
I think they would consider this their own space. They don't want to be a landlord. I've heard them say it many times. They do not want to be a landlord at all. What's the benefit of being a landlord? You have your own building all of a sudden, you got to deal with it.
Well, they have $700,000 plus or minus in capital money now, some kind of, you know, their earnings, whatever they're putting aside. To me, they said more than once they want to see it run like the Amherst or Northampton. Now, that's part of the fire departments. So I don't know what their ultimate goal is, but the response times are like 7 minutes and 10 seconds now, and I think it's been said that if they do indeed move here, it might improve a little bit, but it's working pretty well the way it is now. They just really want to be under one roof for more administrative purposes and things like that. But if we as a town of Whately look at divvying up that 1,500 square feet for them and putting the money into redoing that, then we've got another 2,500 square feet, 1,500 square feet to deal with, that we really don't need another meeting room. You know, we have this, you know, if we end up doing a town hall, we'll have a big room there, we got the school. So if we potentially go ahead with SCIMS, whether it happens in the next 6 months or a year, and they do leave in 3 to 5 years because they want to be in their own space, then we're stuck with two spaces to try to rent. And I think we really got to look at that at this point. Plus, if nothing happens in a year and we can get the school department in there, say by the end of summer or early fall, that's a year's rent that we're getting to offset something that Paul mentioned that if they end up somewhere else. So it's a funny thing with numbers, but I think there's enough mud in the water at this point to you really got to make a decision to move forward for the townspeople.
STEMS isn't going to stay in three locations. I mean, they're just not going to stay one ambulance being housed.
They want to be in one spot.
Well, exactly, because it will save money if it were a cost-effective location. It will save money, it will be administratively stronger. There are a number of reasons why they're doing this. They're not going to stay with one ambulance being housed at the South Deerfield Fire District, another ambulance housed at the Sunderland public safety complex, and another one in our fire department. They're just not going to remain like that. So I go back to, if it's not here, where on earth is it going to be? There is no
hopeless spots. I've been talking.
Not cost effective ones.
Well, we don't know that.
Yeah, we don't.
We don't prejudge other proposals. We have to wait to see what comes in on June 3rd.
So here's what
June 3rd, you're right, I'm sorry.
Here's what I'd like to see. I'd like to see the three boards meet, and I'd like to see somebody from BOO, the Board of Oversight, be at that meeting also, so we have all the players talking to each other in the same place at the same time. Because what we got here is an information issue, and we're trying to make very expensive decisions, and we don't have all the, you know, all the cards aren't on the table yet. So I'd like to see, I mean, I agree with John and Paul on a lot of things, but I'm a little concerned that, you know, we have all the information we need right now to make the best decision in the interest of all three towns and Whately as well.
The other issue that I just noticed a couple of days ago is that the temporary wall that we put up over the winter time, you know, to try to control the heat and the air conditioning in the office area in front of the windows is now down per order of the building inspector. So to me, I think having something happen sooner than later and getting our perimeter walls up to define that space is going to save us a lot of money and discomfort for the employees that are working over there, especially in the summer with the air conditioning. To define that space and have that heating and air conditioning system work the way it should. And until we know who's going to go in there and actually build those walls, it's going to be a mess for them.
I think regardless, if we do submit a proposal, I think the 120 days is too long a time. I would maybe suggest if we do agree to submit a proposal to the RFP, say we need an answer within 60 days. That's our condition. If they don't like it, fine. If they want to talk to
that's
us.
A good point. That's a good point.
If they want to talk to us about it and say, well, we need more time than the 60 days, are you willing to extend it? Well, then we'll know whether they're serious or not. Within 60 days, the school committees maybe will, it's timely enough for them to decide, yes or no. Otherwise, we're going to be dragging on, sitting here waiting for another 2 months.
So, Bob, you have to be able to tell us, or so the school committee has, maybe May 31st, has to be able to tell us what your realistic timeline is. And so if you want to move in, if it happens that the decision is made to have the superintendent's office move in here, how long is that going to take to actually happen? Because we need that information to make an educated decision about what to do with SCEMS and what to do with you guys. And if you can't do it in 2 months, July and August, which is what you would have, if we accelerate the RFP response time, which I agree with Fred, is probably a good idea, because that will give us time to then consider you guys realistically. Otherwise, then we're waiting until next July before you can move in, and that's 12 months of revenue times whatever it is per month revenue we're losing, which, you know, in the great scheme of things may not be a tremendous amount of money, but, you know, it's still something.
Well, that we have our first subcommittee this afternoon at 2 o'clock at the superintendent's office.
Would you let them know our concerns?
Yeah, oh yeah, I will. And like I said, we have a bunch of information that was emailed to me about drafts about location, how much space people need, how big are the cubicles, how much are the cubicles. We've gotten all that to us. We'll be going over all that, and you know, we'll have something to you guys before, I would say maybe before the 31st, so you can look at it, I would say, and we'll have our meeting with you guys on the 31st.
Mark, if we
place in our response our unwillingness to abide by the 120 days and we knock it down by half or whatever. They have every ability to view our response as non-compliant, correct?
You would be considered non-responsive.
Not responsive, right.
Section 18 here, I was just looking up, says all proposals, including the price stated therein, submitted in response to this request for proposals, must remain firm for 120 days following the bid opening.
We won't, if we go against that 120 days, we will not get the bid. We won't.
And the bid opening is June 3rd.
Yes.
Well, but if you look, the other thing, look at the timeline. If you do wait the 120 days, then you need town meeting vote. Well, if we need select board vote, and then you need town meeting vote, and okay, that could be the fall time. Then we've got to advertise for a project here to develop skim. So you're looking another 6 or 9 months before they can actually move in and to get any kind of rent. So you're almost 2 years from today before they're actually going to be in this building.
I guess part of that's going to be solved when we have the conversation with the Deerfield Select Board about revising the IMA. If people aren't willing to revise the IMAs, then what the scenario you just laid out isn't a flawed scenario at all. But we need that information first before we know, because I agree with you, Fred. It's got to be streamlined for expediency.
But still, you're developing the final plans and building and constructing what needs to be there. You can't speed that up very much. It's got to.
Well,
this would also eliminate our original proposal. I mean, we had offered them a year's free.
Well, during construction, while it was being constructed, so you're looking almost 2 years before.
Well, no, I'm saying
you can revise that, you can amend that.
I think
the RFP would do that.
Yeah, right. However we say, it could be 6 months, it could be whatever we decide to do in terms of the financial package of it, which is different, obviously, than the.
But if we told, or has anybody told Skims that we're looking at other tenants?
They know. They're very well aware.
Other tenants for the.
They're very well aware.
A separate but continuing subject, and I know the RFP is what it is. Could we get some input from Mark on what's going to be left on the table? He's got a week and a half left. And I know we're looking at some serious other money issues that I know he was trying to close.
Dan, let's go to the cell tower so these guys don't have to stick around.
Okay.
Before we answer that question, because I see that as somewhat tangential.
That's kind of where I was going.
Right, so let's get the cell tower stuff done. And I don't have all day either. This, you know.
Well, so, none of us do, but can we just resolve that we will have a meeting with the other two select boards?
Mark needs to put that together ASAP.
And maybe have somebody from Boo attend that meeting as well.
Absolutely. Or more than one.
And if finance committee members want to come, great.
Do we know if the new select board members in Deerfield are going to be replacing the members at Skim's Board of Oversight?
I know from the senior center perspective, so I don't know whether it's consistent across the board, that appointments are through the end of June because that's their appointment schedule. I'm guessing that would be the same schedule, but I don't know that for certain.
Does the Board of Oversight, the way it's set up, specify that it shall be two select board members from Deerfield plus one other person?
That was their choice, I believe. The IMA doesn't specify the type of person who's representing any of the towns. It's up to the individual towns. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll proceed with a draft RFP.
Yes, and get a meeting scheduled as quickly as possible.
So
I'm
here.
Okay. Cell tower.
Right. Can I just do a little background on the cell tower just to give you an update on where we're at? So obviously the purpose of this meeting here is to discuss now that the award has been issued to American Tower to decide which of the two payment options we proceed with. On a separate note, I just want to let you know that the town will be receiving a check in the the amount of $10,000 as agreed to in the RFP to cover our legal expenses incurred to date. So now that you guys have awarded that bid to American Tower, we should be getting that check any day now. It's not going to really offset, it's not going to directly offset our legal expenses. It's going to, it's just general revenue, but in theory it is. So so the two options, the next step now would be, which option do we choose? The first option is the lump sum. It's $1.2 million. The second option is 10 annual payments of $165,588.30 a year, for a total of $1,655,833 over 10 years. There was some question about financial risk that came up related to American Tower, and I just wanted to, for what it's worth, mention that we have been working with American Tower for over 20 years now. We have a good working relationship with them. We receive revenue on a regular, steady basis. And as of I did a little research in the back, you know, just to kind of find out what American Tower really is. They're a publicly traded corporation on the New York Stock Exchange. And as of March 10th of this year, the common stock shares were trading at $94.14, representing a market value of $39.87 billion. So I don't think we need to worry too much about whether we're going to get our $1 million.
So the question about the two amounts, the first one was what again, 1.6 million?
1.2.
1.2 or in a lump sum, yep. Or 10 annual payments of $165,588 a year for a total of $1,655,000.
Are those current dollars? So it's a, yes. Both of these are present value numbers?
Yes.
No.
So $455,000 difference between the 1.2 and the 10.
Correct.
So am I wrong in assuming that we should go for the higher amount?
Well, that's what we're going to talk about. And it depends on how you want to utilize the lump sum, if you choose the lump sum.
Well, we can't earn interest on the lump sum, correct? As a
right, you could pay down debt and things like that. So I was working last night and I came up with a couple issues that I want you to consider before we start the conversation here. And this is probably news to most of you because it was news to us as of late last week. Covestro, our neighbor here, has just refiled for manufacturing LLC status, which exempts them from paying personal property taxes going forward. So we currently collect about $220,000 a year in revenue.
We're
going to
lose
$220,000. We're going to lose that. In 2012, you guys planned for that and expected it, but it didn't happen. So at the current moment, we have $220,000 put aside in an overlay account to cover this. And we could, in theory, transfer that money to the overlay account.
Effective when?
Fiscal 17.
They've already
paid their taxes.
Right. So it would be a year from now if that filing happens.
My understanding is that they will not be paying personal property taxes in FY 17.
In our FY 17.
In our FY 17, right. So we could, my understanding is that we would be able to revote that 220 into our current overlay account, but that only gives you a year buffer. You know, it helps for sure, but I think it's an important piece of information to know as we discuss we move forward.
What are we currently getting in revenues from the cell tower? So what's our net annual?
We get about $50,000 a year in revenue from the cell tower now. And we will lose that revenue, obviously,
right,
once we sell the easement.
But our net, we'll have a net gain for right. Some period of time.
Right.
10 years. What else, Mark?
So what I see are a couple options. You know, you have the lump sum option, which you can pay off debt, reduce annual debt service payments. and potentially save money on, not potentially, you would realize the savings on
Not having to pay future interest.
But you know, then again, the flip side is the 10-year payout would provide steady revenue for us for the next 10 years. So there's no clear, obvious best option here, but well, anyway, but I just wanted to give you that background so that you could...
Our debt service is typically in the 4% range in terms of loans. What's that? Less than that?
Yeah.
The difference between 1.2 and 1.65 is not compounding 3.5 to 4%. Personally, I think that if we were to take the lump sum, people would be lining up at the feeding trough. And that's not a criticism. That's just human nature. And then we will be really struggling. Either this group or groups after us will be struggling to figure out how to meet our financial needs going forward. You borrow because it makes things easier.
Right.
But I think that it would also depend on what we're going to do. If we took the lump sum, we're not going to set it in a bank for 10 years and collect interest. I think we've got to look at what would we do with that lump sum. And my thoughts are, if you paid off this building, the loan on this building that's for 10 years, it's $250,000 just interest alone that you would save. And if you look at the 40 years, that's over $600,000 that you would save. And if you want to pay off, looking at paying off debt with that, you could also put in the fire truck in there. That's maybe, what, $5,000 or $8,000 a year for, what, 5 years? On that, that's another $40,000 you're paying interest on a fire truck. You could pay off the two debt services that we have.
I get that, but that solves the reason you borrow is to make your budgeting process easier in the out years.
Right, but there would, well, you're paying $36,000 service on this building, so you wouldn't be paying that amount every year plus the amount every year for the ambulance the fire truck for 5 years. I think in the long run, even after 10 years, you would come out financially ahead if you paid off the two debt services without going to extra 30 years on this building.
How much does this building cost if we bought it today?
We
paid for it.
The principal is $810,000. The interest is $649,000. So the total payment at the end of 40 years is $1,458,800.
So we would save how much? What's the annual interest payment?
Well, it varies.
It varies.
Okay, but the next total, year. Next year.
Next year's interest payment?
Yeah.
$26,320.
And it drops from there?
Yes.
Right. So, okay, so then the interest payment on the fire truck is how much?
The interest payment, I'm not sure.
$5,000, $5,000 or $8,000,
something
like that.
I believe the debt service is in the range of
$88,000. I guess my point is that in not too many years, perhaps a couple, our annual revenue is going to shrink more than our annual savings from paying off debt items. And you will be these guys will be looking for revenue that no longer exists to pay our operating bills. That's just math.
Well, no, but you get the $36,000 a year you're paying on this building.
I understand that. Okay, but Fred, it's $165,000 a year for 10 years. So you've got 36, and then the 23, and then the whatever you're paying for the fire truck, and so you're still looking at $190,000 that you have to find to cover our general operating costs.
Then that wouldn't be there.
Yeah, that wouldn't be there, so you wouldn't have to pay that.
You paid it off, it's gone.
I understand that, but it's... You are going to have revenue to pay for things. We're losing Covestra. You are going to need cash to pay general ops. And the savings you're going to make by paying off the couple, three items that have been listed will not offset that money. You will have a financial deficit.
Well,
Well, after 10 years...
In terms of general operating.
If you look at this building, after 10 years, it's going to equal the...
I understand all that. I'm talking annual general operating that's going to be the challenge. And we will be, and we're going to be in a position where we may have to cut things.
Well, you're going to be saving the $36,000 a year on this.
I understand that, but that doesn't offset the $165,000 in revenue.
You're expecting to expend $165,000?
No, I'm not. I'm hoping.
Well, that would be the offset.
You could put it into.
I know where it could go, but that would be the offset that you're proposing here.
Yeah.
But it'd be a constant for 10 years, is what it's driving.
No, I understand it. I totally get it.
You got to have something for a longer period of time. You just can't look at it for.
No, I get that
one
as
year.
Well.
Okay, but then after 10 years, you still got the $400,000 interest that you're going to pay on this building.
Right. Absolutely.
Right.
Well, you know, I was figuring this morning and last night about, you know, taking it over 10 years, figuring that if we did that and paid off $65,000 extra on principal for that 10 years, then that loan would be paid off. Mark told me this morning that the USDA would then, if we started paying extra on a principal, then USDA would look at it as now we have more ability to pay and pull the loan, say go get your private financing. Given the other fact that, you know, whatever's going to happen with the space out there, we don't have any outside control of, you know, getting a independent company or whatever in there. While we still have that loan, I think you really got to look at that too, because that's kind of putting a control factor on what we can do with the rest of that space. As long as we have that loan, we're limited as to who can be in there.
Who can be in there, absolutely. Right.
So, paying it off may not be a bad thing, I guess, at this point.
Let's say we get the lump sum payment. That goes in the general fund.
If you were to close on a contract and receive that money prior to June 30th, that would roll to free cash this fall. Anything after June 30th would roll to free cash the following.
To be certified in October.
Right.
When we have a free cash beginning of this year, north of six, right? North
six
of five.
We did,
right, that's my point. And look what happened to it. I'm not saying the expenses were poor expenses to incur, but look what happened to it. We came down to what we are usually at for free cash nearing the end of the fiscal.
I see this as an opportunity to pay off our debt. And in the long run, we're gonna save the town the taxpayers' money. I think that's one of the commitments we need to consider as a board is keeping taxes low, our expenses low, our debt low. We've got a debt that's going to be here for 40 years.
Well, Fred, the
and
problem.
We have the opportunity to do something with that debt today.
And
if we don't do it today, you probably won't have that opportunity to pay it off again.
And Fred, you will if you do that. Your math is right on the debt, but if you do that, you will be looking for where to cut. Because we won't have a revenue stream in fiscal 18 that we used to.
We can't project that far ahead of time for the revenue stream. I don't think that's a practical answer to put money away just because we don't know what's going to happen for revenue in the future. Nobody's going to know that. And well, if we need more revenue, well, we'll deal with it at that time, I think. But now is the time where we have a debt.
But, you know, that was the comment I was going to make, and I get the commercial piece, the restriction on using this space if we have the USDA loan. But that means you also can't project that we'll be able to actually find a tenant. We might be able to, we might not. We can't count on those things. So you can't project at one point and not project at another point. We will have either to find new revenue or we will be making budget cuts.
Well, I don't think we can plan that far ahead of time.
It's 2 years away. It's two years away. If you can't plan 2 years away, we've got bigger issues.
We've got options for 2 years now of revenue sources, whichever way we go here. But beyond that, I don't think we can plan. I don't know, Finance Committee, how far ahead you can plan for revenues and expenses and whatever. So.
well, just, you know, if we did take the lump sum, let's just split them up, okay, because things are getting all kind of enthralled here. But if we did take the lump sum, do you feel that Fred's option here is a reasonable way to go? If you did take the lump sum to pay to drop the debt,
it's not outlandish. I mean, it's a viable option, certainly. Okay. If you did that.
So, what weighs against that is $450,000 that we leave on the table.
Possibly.
No, definitely.
Well, but definitely. It depends what's against that. What you're paying for 10 years against that.
450 minus your 36 grand a year that you're paying.
Yeah, plus you're paying.
The interest that you would save.
That's what you got to look at now.
Right.
So look at the whole picture.
360,000 mm-hmm. minus, you know, from the 450, then you're only talking about
424. 434, yeah, and then so you're down to four in year one of 23,000 in interest, but that debt payment's going to go down. It's not going to go up in out years.
So that reduces that even more.
That reduces what even more?
Well,
no, 250 over 10 years, and it's what, 650 over the life of the loan.
Right, but it's but that's 40
the first,
years.
The first 10 years, Fred, the interest yeah. is a lot higher than
right.
the average
right.
five.
Yeah.
So that's, you got to look at the actual interest numbers yeah. on that sheet.
Yeah.
The interest in year 20 is not going to be a big enough.
If you still pay the building, you still have 400,000 left.
In year one.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So what do you do with the 400,000? Pay off the fire truck.
Or that, or use it to bring us through the next offset. Couple of years.
Yeah.
You got 220.
You got the truck for five, and you can just let it run.
Yeah, I mean, a truck is a low interest, what, 2.25 or something, 2.5 rates, so.
People will be lining up. Well, their money's sitting there. Their money's sitting
well,
there.
Well, the thing is, the other part of it is, this is, you know, a one-time, one and only sale. It's a big number for our town. And I think individuals are going to want to know what happened to that money. Granted, we take down the 165 per year, it can go into operating, but it will be whittled away. And you'll never be able to put a stake in the ground and say, this is what we did with that money.
We bought this with it.
Yeah.
So that's a consideration. I'm not saying it's everything, it's just,
let's assume that Covestra is not paying us $220,000 a year, starting right away, and we've got the 200. We've got the 220 for fiscal 17. You guys are going to find, and I don't mean to pick on the finance committee, but the departments are going to have to find $220,000 worth of cuts.
Well, they've got two more years if we only pay the building.
Well, we actually have three, because you right. said you put 200 away in expectation of him going. You had four left over from the 1.2. So that leaves you 3 years to plan ahead for not having
right, but
revenue.
It's still going to be...
It doesn't make it go away.
It doesn't make it go away.
No.
It makes the planning process
not. Nothing's going to make it go away.
But you're still going to have cuts.
Get the mm-hmm. $400,000 to deal with and cover something. Oh, yeah.
That Covestra has made our lives so much easier over the past half dozen, 8 years.
Okay, but you also got to look at growth in the town. Our experience is some growth, so that's going to be reduced every year. Not saying $200,000, but
I mean, luckily taxes. This is happening now. Imagine if we didn't have the cell tower and Covestra yeah. was going anyway. You know?
Oh, I totally get it. We'd still have the $50,000 in revenue, and that was it from, you know, from right. present day. Right. It's a problem, but I just we're not very good at saying no.
That's absolutely true.
So what makes us think that we're suddenly going to get good at it?
Well, I think if we, you know, once we've come to an agreement here as to how we move forward on a budget process, what that timeline looks like, and if we have, if we have a stronger eye on what the tax rate is and what generally we think the tax rate should be, then I think you have pushback. Right now, we kind of work the other way, and it's just, you don't know what you're pushing against. You're only pushing against what seems right or wrong, or what it, you know, and it, you're not pushing back against a hard and fast number, which is where the Finance Committee would like to get. And I think when we get there, then I think you will be deeply questioning whether or not that fire truck should be, or whether there should be a new dump truck, or whatever the request. And but that'll be the stake in the sand. Right now, we really kind of don't have that.
So I think a couple of considerations I've been mulling over are, one goes into debt to buy something that one can't afford to buy outright. That's usually the reason one goes into debt, like a mortgage. Mm-hmm. Nobody can afford to buy a house outright, or not many people. So you go into debt. We've gone into debt to buy this building and get a good rate. And going into debt isn't a bad thing per se, because it allows you to buy things you otherwise couldn't buy.
Right.
And then you have to consider opportunity costs. So what else could you have used that money to buy if you don't, you know, spend it on X, like this building? And what's your return on investment with that other option? And is that more in your favor than eliminating interest on, say, this building and the fire truck or whatever we'd spend the $1.2 million on? But unlike a private investor, and I could be wrong about this, it doesn't seem like we have an investment opportunity that would give us a better return to choose from. Our only options are to eliminate other debts.
Right.
So therefore, it seems to me to make sense to try to eliminate debts. You know, we're not in the business to invest and make profits as a municipality. So what we are in business to do is to make it to ease the tax burden and to provide the services the taxpayers require,
right,
to lead a whole life. Mm-hmm. So I think there's an argument. I get John's idea that if we take all the money at once, well, I think this is what you're saying. The tendency will be there'll be a feeding frenzy at the trough, and we'll just spend it all. And then we're going to be stuck with this $200,000 or $220,000 yearly deficit.
And we have a shorter glide path towards figuring out how to solve general operating deficits.
Right, so it's a buffer. Buffering it out, literally,
yeah,
over time, buys us some time to do some planning and not be tempted to spend it all at once. But as I said, on the other hand, and this is, you know, the old economist thing, it's what Hoover wanted was a one-handed economist, so the economist wouldn't be able to say, but on the other hand, that's a joke.
Gotcha.
So, however, there's a lot of truth to that, because I think I've heard two very good arguments for doing two very different things. And I don't know the numbers well enough to say it doesn't make sense to not buy the building and eliminate the interest payments as well. So we get it all at once, as opposed to metering it out, and we eliminate the interest payments. But I'm not sure what the net cost to the town is in the future after we do that, and then we're faced with this lack of revenue from Covestro. Well,
you know, the number that's going to be staring us, the Finance Committee, in the eye every year is the $810,000, or the interest payment on it, to $36,000. You're going to have to look at that every year for the next 39 years. And as far as is people waiting in line, if we took a lump sum and didn't know what to do with it, or even the 10-year payment, we have a process to deal with that, with people waiting in line. You have a capital improvement committee, you have a finance committee. If that's working effectively, there is a process to deal with that. It's not like they're going to be coming here every meeting to the select board asking for a project.
That's not the process. If it's not working to deal with that, then we need to change it. We are talking about making that more effective. So I guess I don't see that as a deterrent, not to have money sitting available because people are going to be standing in line. I don't see that as an issue.
But Fred, it's more than just capital projects. People will be standing in line for general.
Well, it doesn't matter whatever they're standing in line for.
When the schools, not this past fiscal 16 discussions, when the schools were talking about cutting one full time and a couple, maybe half time FTEs, they were people at town meeting who were going to be the ones who lose their jobs. If we have an operating deficit because we've lost Covestro and we don't have the buffer any longer, there will be people at town meeting who will be there saying, this isn't an imaginary thing. This is my job.
I guess we can't look at that. What's going to happen in it? Yeah, we should be aware of what's happening, but we can't use that as a decision making element today to say, well, we don't want that to happen to our schools in the future, so we should plan on additional revenue.
I'm not saying schools. I'm saying
or anything. So in case that happens, we need to have money in the pot somewhere to cover that. I don't think we're in a position to do that today. And I don't think that should something that the Finance Committee should be considering.
Not only that, the pushback against schools is very tough. Yeah. Right. I mean,
But I'm just picking on schools. It could have been anything. Well, could have been anybody with
it. Yeah, it
just happened to them.
But if you're concerned about too many people asking for the same dollar, then you earmark this right. for something very specific before it gets here. We make a decision, this is where the money's going to go, and it's not going to go into the general fund, and it's not going to be available for whatever.
Does that come down to a select board vote?
Yeah.
Let's just say...
Or town meeting.
Or is it town meeting? You say we're going to pay pay the building. Is that a vote on this floor right now?
That's a good question.
But my guess is it's time meeting because one point, if we were to buy it, it's our decision whether to buy it outright or not. And let's say we take the cash, $1.2 million. It goes into free cash. What to do with free cash when it's certified in the fall is a decision of town meeting.
Yeah, you're right, it is.
Okay, so what I would like to see, and if I were on the Finance Committee, this is what I would be asking for, a little hint, I'd like to see a cash flow analysis over time for both options. Taking into account the reduction of interest payments we might be able to make if we metered this over 10, 20 years, or by buying the building or the fire truck lump sum, and compare that with, as Jonathan's proposing, more steady outflow, see what the present value of both of those streams are, because I can't do this in my head. I don't know. I'd be voting. Like I say, I think both arguments make a lot of sense to me, but I haven't run the numbers.
Yeah, if you could have both, it'd be great.
Well, we can't do both. Yeah. But you know, and
but we can run the numbers for each and then make a decision.
And again, what I would propose under the 160 a year to make it really tough for people is, and again, I'm just thinking out loud here. You take $165,000 a year. And you immediately put it into stabilization so that any spending plan needs to be two-thirds vote at town meeting. If the town overwhelmingly, 67%, wants to spend it on salaries or whatever, that's their decision. If the town wants to spend it on buying Christmas presents for everybody in Whately, that's their decision. But at least if you put it into stabilization, you have that cautionary tale.
So the actual vote of how the lump sum, if that's a choice, gets used would be in town meeting.
On an right.
Because I was...
Spending.
Yeah. Because I was thinking, I agree with Paul in that we always have to justify what we do to the residents of the town. And to be able to say, we paid off this building, that we did not have this debt prior to this. We were meeting in town halls and whatever. And I think that would justify that decision, because they want to see where the money, what it was used for. And that's huge, to be able to say, okay, we took on this huge debt, and now it's gone, for the most part, and we have a little residual left. But if we can't make that decision, other than to say we go around with the lump sum, then it's still going to be the town, and then they would justify the use of it instead of that being on our backs. They could say we could pay off the loan, or we could pay off the
but at that
equipment.
Point, that's when it would be a frenzy.
Right.
But I think
it's not going to be that easy, because at that point there's going to be a lot of different ideas to do it, and they're going to be sitting there arguing about, well, which one of those loans you pay off, how do you do this,
right.
You keep the money for this. I think the lower price is a better way to go myself.
Over which 10 one?
Years. 165.
Well, I think it's going to, I guess you'd have to have recommendations right. from the Finance Committee and Select Board at the town meeting as to what to do with the money. And, well, yeah, I guess it's up to a two-thirds vote to, as a final say. But
we have to decide very soon whether the lump sum or the
right.
yearly yeah. payments. And I repeat my point, I don't know enough. It's always a lack of information today.
But do we have enough time to be educated?
Do we have enough time to be educated about what the cash flows are for each scenario, which should
have? Right, I think you have to take into consideration everything
yeah.
that they brought up about,
right now it's a very short window to get into this fiscal year. Right?
I'm not sure it's even possible to pull it off
for the
pre-June 30th closing anyway, to be honest with you, so.
We'd have to have the money in our account by then.
We close our books on June 30th.
When do we need to let American Tower know of our decision? There's a time window on that.
Yes, I have a contract here for you to sign. It's still under review from council right now, so.
But wasn't it 60 days after we accepted their bid or something?
Well, you met the 60-day deadline by awarding the bid within 60 days.
Okay.
My understanding is that we now have 60 days to close the deal, or we have to have a mutual agreement to extend the offer with American Tower.
Okay, well, so we're not sweating.
We
right
figure
now.
Out the payout method during that extension, or what?
The only way you can go over the 120-day total would be if both parties agree. Their offer is valid for the 120 days, so it's in total control for the next 60 days.
It's too late for any negotiations, basically. For example, if we asked an accountant for $800,000 now on the balance over 10 years at the same annual earnings rate, at the 1.6 offers. I mean, it's too late for any type of negotiation.
That would have had to have been the RFP.
It would have had to have been the RFP. It was structured to give you this option of choosing a lump sum or a 10-year payment.
You know, just another thought on, whether the 1.2 or the 1.6. If we take the 1.6 and we get that $165K every year for 10 years, essentially nothing changes in this town. Things, because we're going to lose 220 from that side.
Right.
In fact, we're maybe got a little bit of a loss. So there's nothing, there will never, ever be anything to show for this cell tower versus with the 1.2. I understand about the operating and all, but if you go to 1.2 and you make the decision to pay this thing off, we've really done something rather than just hold the dike back.
But you know, Paul, we've never, how long has the cell tower been around for? 20 years now? Something, we've never had anything to show for. So that's not anything new. The town has used $50,000 a year to work and make its budget work. So all of a sudden, having something to show for a cell tower, that's the new thing.
Well, that's because we've never had anything this large to sell.
I get that, right. I get that, but you get my point. All of a sudden, we're looking for something to put a stamp on from something that we've never put a stamp on before.
Well, I think to use the Covestro loss of income is kind of clouding the situation because you're assuming nothing else is changing. John is selling lots every day or whatever, and we're getting growth in there.
Really?
We're getting growth on top of the hill in West Whately.
You have
to figure that into your total revenue. Just not saying we're going to lose.
Wait. Time out. You're talking about $220,000 in loss of revenue from Covestro. As compared to when John sends a house, and it doesn't have to be John, it could be any house lot, of 1 acre with a, you know, with a 2,000 square foot house on it. You know, you're talking a tax bill of $3,000, $5,000. You're not selling that many.
Hold on. Wait. When you're talking about tax revenue from a residential lot, you've got to figure in services. It's not $5,000 income. It's $5,000 minus whatever to supply fire service.
So let's not compare. That's just
no. But you still got to look at growth that's happening in the town. You just can't look at the negative side to say that you're losing $220,000 a year or $200,000.
All right, we're losing $180,000 a year. I don't know what it is.
Well, you're losing the $220,000.
You just are
$220,000 plus you're losing the $50,000. That you get every year from the cell tower company.
Right. It's a big nut we're losing. And if anyone doesn't think that's going to impact our general operations budget, it's just not the case.
And as far as development goes, I would be pro-development if two things. Whoever buys the lots doesn't have children because they're expensive, so we don't want that. I'm kidding. It's a Jonathan Swift sort of allegory here. But they do cost more. They're net loss, revenue-wise, families with kids. What we need are old people, rich old people, who build very expensive houses on little plots and don't use much services. Perfect. But, you know, I'm being a little
cynical. Which is why you need scams.
then we can put surcharges on things like, you know, service.
And we keep putting all the money into chapter, and so, you know, we can't develop anyone in town anymore. It's almost 10 o'clock here, so.
Yeah.
You know, the thing about the numbers and getting these analysis and all, still not going to
reflect the outside issue of USDA controlling what we can put in here.
Well, that's
and
true.
I think you have to look at that as far as a revenue stream, short term and long term.
Right, but you can't be absolutely confident that we would get a private company to want to rent space here. We might, right. We might not. There's just no way of knowing that.
But just the limitation on who can.
Eventually, yes. But you know, let's say, and I think it's pretty clear that I want scams in this building and not the schools. But let's say that even the schools were in here. Well, then it doesn't matter whether we have USDA restrictions or not, because they're not going to go anywhere, the schools. And I don't think SCEMS would go anywhere, because there's a cost to them moving, to either entity moving. So once one of those two entities is in this building, I don't think it matters. I'd be hard-pressed to say, yeah, but in 10 years, when they're gone, I don't know that they will be. I think there's a better shot at one of those not existing than them deciding to move.
And just as a sidebar on that, on the school, I think you guys need to get something in black and white really hard before there's a little group in Deerfield that wants to get together and say, oh,
superintendent's office over here.
I have a building for you.
Because you're starting out. You know, the same way.
I would get that in black and white hard and fast as soon as possible.
Nothing in writing.
I can see them putting it in with their SCEMS and the school.
Plan. Well, it turned out you don't need anybody. It's not the school that's
there. You go.
Or anything.
There you
the
go.
Your building.
Basement.
Yeah. It just
$36,000 a year.
I wish we could. I'm gonna not say what I was gonna say because Chris Collins is here.
The meeting is happening, and then whatever the last.
So
writing for the
town.
All right, you know what? How much time do we have to? This has been a great meeting, by the way, in terms of discussing the pros and cons of the 1.2, 1.6
in terms of the process. But I think he's right. You really need to see it all in black and white and see exactly what the numbers say. I mean, it's easy to kick around 165 versus 1.2, you know, but until you do some of the projections and, you know, what are we going to save on interest or not.
So now I'm going to bring my question back. Mark has 1.5 weeks left. You guys need to decide what he's going to spend his 1.5 weeks on. It sounds like he just got about 3 weeks assignment here.
There are 24 hours in a day, Dan.
Well, this is true. I tell him he has the long weekends. I tell him that all the time.
Who's going to do the analysis? Is the finance board going to do that, or are you asking Mark to do that?
Well, Mark's going to do that.
Well, wait a second.
I mean, that's a fine skill set.
This is a technical analysis. We have an accountant, don't we? If we gave the accountant the relevant figures, like the interest and the capital costs and blah, 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 and said, we want to know what the better decision is over the long term.
I'm not sure he's an analyst, though. This is an analyst's job. This isn't an accountant.
Out of Scanlon, or whoever it is?
Ray Ellsworth.
Okay.
But only because he's here Monday mornings and his work is...
Well, you know what? Let me ask you a question. Does the COG have an analyst?
Or UMass Business School?
Some student who needs a community service credit to graduate. We need an analyst. We don't need a CPA. We need an analyst.
How about a treasurer?
What?
A treasurer.
I don't think she has that. Maybe. Cash.
I mean, I don't think it's just numbers.
Just numbers.
It's that complicated.
They pay analysts a lot. They pay analysts a lot of money for some of this stuff.
Warren.
So all right. Back to my question: Who's going to do it?
Warren.
Can you call the COG and see if they've got anybody?
Sure.
Because I want Mark to do the SCIMS RFP.
Okay. I do too.
I've got a couple items I want to discuss before we convene. Unless Mark is.
How long is this going to take? Because this meeting was not supposed to take an hour and a half, and.
We've got 5 minutes at most.
We need to sign the election warrant. That's coming your way right now.
Mark, what do we got? Because I got to make a little.
The election warrant is one item that we have here. And the last thing I had, you signed the warrant.
Yeah.
The only other thing then is Memorial Day ceremony on May 29th.
I will not be here, unfortunately.
I will not be here.
Okay. Fred, can you raise the flag?
Yes.
Great.
Okay. A couple things come to my attention, building committee and others. Green Communities grant, I guess we got one a few years ago.
Yep.
And there was an opportunity for the town to apply again this fall, but one of the conditions is the money we received had to be spent and a report turned in before we applied for a new grant. What is happening with that, and is that going to happen soon? Because we're looking at that as a possible source for town hall funding. There's a grant for that funding, so.
There is still Green Communities funding available. I think it's in the range of $160,000.
No, we spent what we applied for and received, though, a few years ago.
There's still a balance in that account, though.
There is, because that was all going to the schools, as I recall.
Yeah, the money, Bob Lesko right now is looking into controls for the elementary school, which will absorb all of that money. So he's aware, I filed for an extension last year because the money was expiring on December 31st. I filed for an extension, which gave us another year. So the money expires at the end of this calendar year now. I did email Bob a few months ago and I said, reminder, this money will go away at the end of the year. There's no guarantees they'll grant another extension. And he is, to the best of my knowledge, actively pursuing the control project.
What's his timing on that? Because Fred's point is we need to apply for the next tranche.
I can check in with him. I haven't had a conversation with him in probably.
Because if he doesn't make that happen, you know, I'd be all for, you know, slapping solar on the highway and police station and cutting our electric bill in the town.
I'll find out and get back.
Right, because that, and there's supposed to be a report submitted at the end of the year or something on that.
We do that every year. We submit a report.
Right, what else, Brett?
Okay, maintenance. I know you're looking at a maintenance or janitorial contract, whatever. Mm-hmm. I think also need to include some time for the town hall. It's our building and we need to maintain it. Not saying every week or same schedule as this, but periodically, if there's meetings, I mean, it needs to be kept clean. There's nothing happening now.
No, right. And maybe that could fall. But, I mean, we don't have the money in our budget for the janitorial services now. So adding on to it would be difficult. But if we hire, we're discussing, just so everyone knows, we're discussing, rather than having an employee on the books that's being used as a janitor at the library now, combining a position that would include janitorial services for this building and the library, whether that's through a private contractor or an employee. I'm meeting with a private contractor this week to look at both and get a proposal from them. I can also take him to town hall and look at it. It would just be a matter of finding.
Well, but let's also not forget that if by the grace of God, construction actually happens on that building someday of one kind or another, it's going to be a construction site and we're not going to be having cleaning happening for that window of time. So
it's not being used by town entities right now. So
right.
We're going to be cleaning up after.
And we can't do that.
We're going to be, right, and that's kind of why I cut off the services to that building when we moved here. We needed Keith and his guys, we needed their energy and time here rather than cleaning up after the snowmobile club, the Grange, and then no offense to any of those organizations, but they're not town organizations, so.
We can't clean, we can't spend money, town money on that.
The deal was when we vacated that building, you clean up after yourself. We're not coming into empty trash cans anymore, so if you have a party, you bring it in, you take it out.
Right. Okay, so, well, can you inform them people that are using it that that's their responsibility?
They're aware of that. They should be aware of that. We made that clear when we moved our town offices out of there.
All the trash.
Okay, well, that came up. The last thing is, On the town hall renovations, we're looking at doing some investigative work on the building. So when we deal with the RFP responses, we can tell the contractor or architect what actually needs to be replaced that's not visible today, like the flooring, underneath the flooring, under above the ceiling on the second floor. And the building committee wants to do some investigative work, that the foundation, the floor joists, whatever, and to use some of the money that I guess Mark has in a maintenance account for town buildings. We're looking, I don't know, several thousand dollars maybe, to hire somebody to do that. So we have a better idea when we're dealing with a contractor.
Didn't the architects do that?
No. They guessed at it because they didn't have access to everything in the building. We paid extra for them to look at some of that stuff, but it was only limited, and a lot of land stayed verified in field or will be determined later on. So we've got some unknowns. We want to do some investigative work, like I say, so in a better position to know what actually needs to be done to be replaced.
Is there some money left in that account?
There's some money in that account now. We have not paid any June bills yet. So
back from the window deal and all that.
John, did you want to say any more on that?
Well, yeah, in fact, with the building inspector over a couple of times and him coming out there, it was suggested that we might want to do this step
which is basically you, as the Board of Selectmen, would apply for a demolition permit just so we can open up the floor, like in the front closets, and gain access to the underneath there and actually see what's there and work with the structural engineer that did the initial report, who didn't have access at the time, just to verify, you know, what's there and the extent of what's needed to be done. So whoever the new architect, if it's a new architect or whether it's the existing one, they can move on from there and not go through that step again. It's not a big deal. Part of the project that we're kind of talking about here is cleaning up the attic space too, of the bat droppings and bird droppings. And there was a quote in the plans that we paid $187,000 for, and that was for like $2,500 for cleaning up that. So basically, you know, getting an environmental company up there, clean it up, so then the structural engineer can actually lift the insulation, look at the main beams and all that stuff. So it's not a very big process, but I think it should be done at this point.
So the current account pay for that? We can cover it with the current account again?
It depends on the cost that we have.
I'm waiting to hear back from the structural engineer. He moved from Northampton to Greenfield, and I put a call into him yesterday.
What did it's hell with, Greg?
Yeah.
What did he look at?
Just what they could see.
You know, like the pictures that are in that, the summary findings report. Right. I thought they were looking at the crawl space underneath the building.
Cut a hole in the floor and looked at it.
That hole turns out to be the top of the stage, looking at the floor underneath it.
How much did they charge for that? A hole in the first floor.
So do we.
How much did they charge for that?
For what?
To do what they did.
The structural analysis.
That was part of Jones Woodset contract.
Oh, so we don't know. There was a subcontractor thing, okay.
But a lot of things that Fred says, you know, when you look at the plans that were drawn up, it shows some concrete posts, concrete footings, things like that. And then mainly for the west end of the building, it's all got VIF, verify infield, because they don't know.
Okay.
They couldn't see. So it's simply...
Let's find the cost and find out how much money we have left after the current bills are paid. And you got to do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're good.
Motion to adjourn.
It was a pleasure to have the finance committee.
I really did enjoy this meeting, you guys.
I did too.
We will do it
once a month.